Ladies and gentlemen, in the next panel, the new reality post-COVID-19 cybercrime and financial fraud cybersecurity challenges. Please welcome Dr. Habel at Faculty of Economics and Business Administration of the Babes Bojai University, Ms. Monica Violeta Akim, Project Manager, Cybercrime Program Office, Council of Europe, Mr. Giorgi Giocadze, Cybersecurity Program Manager, Integrated Intelligence, Defense and Security Solutions, Mr. Mircea Schiau. The moderator of this panel is Executive Director of the Moldovan Association of ICT Companies, Ms. Marina Bzovi.
Hello everyone, and welcome again to the next panel of Cyber Week 2020 Moldova. We are happy to have three of the most wonderful speakers that we can have for the Cyber Week in Moldova. And this panel is basically dedicated to the new realities post-COVID. We know that due to COVID, we had to start doing our businesses remotely. What does this mean? This means that all the business sector had to adjust immediately and drastically to new realities. It had to involve new security measures, which probably they were not ready for. When we talk about this, it's not only about businesses, it's also about governments and governmental institutions, which also have to ensure the security of each meeting, each ministerial meeting, each group meeting, which happens within governmental authorities. This being said, today we're going to go into in-depth of the financial frauds and challenges. We are going to have Ms. Monica being the first speaker of this panel, presenting you more details about figures, what's happening, what changed, and maybe we can address more questions about the new realities post-COVID. We will also be able to jump into the latest figures. We know very well that only in 2018 figures shows that the fraud business, it's about $1 trillion. Therefore, Ms. Monica, who's the representative of the Faculty of Economics and Business from the University Babes Bojai, is present with us right now. I hope you can hear us, and I'll give the floor to you to start your presentation, and I'll be happy to be with you here.
Thank you very much, Marina, and thank you all. My name is Monica Violeta Akim. I am professor at Babes Bojai University, Cluj-Napoca, Romania, Faculty of Economics and Business Administration. Our faculty is the highest in Romania. Actually, we have over 10,000 students. And also our university was the highest in the ranking, meta rankings of university. A recent meta rankings told us that we are now on the top, on the first place among the university from Romania. I would like to thank for being invited here in this important event, and I am very honored about this, and also happy to be here with you.
We are happy to have you on board, and thank you so much for preparing the presentation together with Mr. Mircea Constantin Schiau. We know that he's not physically, in a way, we're never connected, but actually the presentation which you are bringing is a work done together.
Of course. I just want to say that my work is realized together with my colleague, Professor PhD Mircea Constantin Schiau from the University of Craiova, also from Romania. Our research concerned the new dimension of economics and financial crimes within the digital economy. We would like to present several concepts, then several issues on statistics of crimes, the profile of perpetrators, Then several methods or measures to combat economic and financial crime, and at the end we will end with our conclusions. Regarding the main concept, we have to say that at the international level, there is no common definition given to all the states regarding the economic and financial crime. But in practice, this concept is associated to various deeds, such as corruption, tax evasion, fraud, cybercrime, money laundering, accounting frauds accounting book, and many other. Within the digital economy, the economic and financial crimes face new dimensions. The level of digital economy increases year by year, as we may see in this graph. According to the Digital Economy and Society Index, calculated by European Commission, all the five components of this index increase year by year among the European Union countries. We talk about a score for connectivity, for human capital, use of internet, integration of digital technology, and digital public services. Within the digital economy, the economic and financial crimes face new dimensions. The level of digital economy among the countries, we may say it differs. Actually, we have gaps between the two blocks, Central and Eastern European economies, and here, and Western economies. According to the most recent Digital Economy and Society Index 2020, the northern countries, such as Finland, Sweden, Denmark, and the Netherlands, have the most advanced digital economies in the European Union, while Bulgaria, Greece, Romania, Italy have the lowest level of digitalization. Despite the well-known benefits of digitalization, one of them being that we are able now to meet each other in this important event, even in the context of pandemic, there are also negative consequences regarding facing the abusive use of technology to generate financial benefits in the form of cybercrime. Cybercrime may be used within a company to create and alter the digital documents. Within a company, we may note from this figure that top four concealment methods used by fraudsters are represented by fraudulent created and altered of physical documents, which are then combined with created and altered the digital document. So understanding the methods used by fraudsters to hide their crime may help organizations to detect and prevent similar scam in the future. Now we are moving our attention to the subject of crime statistics. For the first, according with the study of PricewaterhouseCoopers, the first category of frauds by types are represented by customer fraud, actually fraud to the clients, followed very close to the cybercrime, then assets misappropriation, bribery, and financial statement frauds. When we talk about frequency of frauds by domains, we may note that customer frauds highly occur in consumer markets and then in financial services in relation with the bank. Then cybercrime frauds are found on the first place where in the government and public sector, then in health industries, and then in technology, media, and telecommunications. However, top frauds by domains differ when we talk about number of fraud cases or when we talk about value of losses. Thus, when we talk about number of cases, we may see that on the first place, there are banks and financial services, then government and public administration, and then manufacturing. Then when we talk about the value of losses, the mining hold the first place, and then real estate and telecommunications. In Romania, a frequency of frauds by domains based on the data provided from Romanian police is presented in this graph. And we may say that on the first place with 18%, there are the financial frauds which occur in banks and financial institutions. Also, like in the study of PricewaterhouseCoopers, then we have buildings and food industry. As regard frequency of fraud by types of entities, the most fraudulent companies are the private companies, followed then by public company. We may see that the percent of cases in private company are about 44%, then in public company 26%. However, when we talk about the value of losses, they are the same. Both in private company and public company, we have the same value of losses. Let's talk about corruption as the first component of crime, which goes hand in hand with many other types of crimes. According with Corruption Perception Index, calculated for European Union countries, we may find that also the northern countries, Denmark, Finland, Sweden, Netherlands, are the least corrupt countries in the European Union, while the Central and East European country, rather we talk about the East European country, Bulgaria, Hungary, Croatia, Romania, Greece, Slovakia, are the most corrupt country according with this score. Regarding the evolution of corruption in European Union countries over the period 2005 and 2019, we may note very small fluctuations during this period. Thus, despite the efforts made by the organizations, corruption still remains a long-standing problem among European Union countries. Then let's talk about shadow economy, another component, important component of economic and financial crime. As regard the level of shadow economy determined as percent in GDP, we may note that among the European Union countries, the average value of shadow economy is about 17%, meaning that 17% from GDP is lost in shadow in average annually, taking in account this period. We may also observe that the discrepancies between countries are very high. The countries which face the lowest level of shadow economy are Austria, Luxembourg, Croatia, Germany, Sweden, while the country with the highest level are Cyprus, Bulgaria, Romania, Croatia, Greece. However, when we talk about the evolution of shadow economy, we may note a decreasing trend of shadow economy year by year among the European country and also in Romania. This percent decrease from 31% in 2005 and until 23% in 2017. So we have a reduce of about 8% points. In the same trend with the shadow economy, tax evasion as a main component of shadow economy, as we know, along with undeclared work, registers also significant decrease in Romania in the last 5 years, about 40%. Another component of financial crime is money laundering. As regards the risk of money laundering, according with Basel anti-money laundering score, which range between 0 to 7, we know that the average of this risk is about 4, taking in account the last 8 years, because only from 2012 we have this score provided by the Basel. The money laundering crimes somehow differ than other types of crimes, such as corruption, shadow economy, or tax evasion, because money laundering are more spread in rich countries where big transactions are conducted by rich and high situated position entities, so-called white collars. Thus, we may see from the graph that the highest risk of money laundering is found for this time in developed countries such as Luxembourg, Greece, Italy, Germany, Austria, while the lowest risk of money laundering is found in Central and East European countries such as Estonia, Slovenia, Lithuania, and Bulgaria. Although the general average value of anti-money laundering risk, this score is still high also among the country. Also, we may found a reduction of them in the last 8 years as a result of anti-money laundering regulations. However, in Romania, the risk of anti-money laundering started to increase since 2016. That's all about money laundering, and let's go to the other component of economic and financial crime, cybercrime. So this is the new dimension of financial crime in the digital era under the form, this form of cybercrime. It is interesting to find that according to Global Security Index in calculated for European Union members, Malta, Greece, Czech Republic and Cyprus are the most vulnerable countries in terms of cyber attacks. The lowest risk of cyber attacks are found in France, Lithuania, Estonia and Spain.
Monica, I see that Romania is also somewhere in the end, Romania. Can you give more insights about this? Since you are...
I have, I can provide also issues about Romania. Yes, if you ask for this, I can provide.
That would be great.
Okay, together with my colleague, actually, we decide to not talk very much about Romania because nobody would be interested in Romania, but rather in general what's happening in European countries. But if you ask for this information, I may provide. Okay. Related to cyber, yes. We find that this risk of cyber attack is lower in the East European Central countries. We are here, actually, Romania is on the third position in terms of the risk of the cyber attacks. So we are not in a very good position from this point of view. Related to the cyber attack, the number of malware applications developed in the last 10 years highly increased. Actually, in the last 3 years, they increased with about 3 times, as we may see from this graph. Cybercrime has been counteracted over time by investment in IT equipment to protect against this risk. This statistic shows the global spending on cybersecurity during the last 4 years. We may see from the graph that in 2009, spending in cybersecurity industry reached around $40 billion, with forecasts suggesting that the market will reach about $43 billion by 2020, as the best case scenario, taking into account the coronavirus pandemic. Regarding the perception about the development of cybercrime risk, according with a recent study provided by Eurobarometer, it was found that about 76% of respondents stated that they agree with the statement, "Do you believe the risk of becoming a victim of cybercrime is increasing?" So they state that indeed there is an increase risk of cybercrime. We have also here data regarding Romania, if you ask for this. Similarly, according with a big study conducted by European Union Agency for Fundamental Rights, more than one in two people in the European Union countries, actually among 55%, are concerned about their online data, actually about the information they share on the internet and social media, are concerned about being accessed by criminal and fraudster. We may see here that Romanian people are not very concerned on this. The Romanian people don't realize the risk of being their data could be attacked. Okay. Another important result provided by the same source regards the degree in which people worry about having their online bank account or credit debit card details misused in the next 12 months. We may see from this graph that one in four people in the European Union are very worried about the unauthorized use of their online bank account or credit card account in the new 12 months. In addition, 6 of 10 persons are very and somewhat worries about this risk. Regarding this, Romania is situated in a good position regarding there's money. Romanian people are somehow concerned, not like in the previous result. So they are concerned about there's money. One result regarding this source provided by European Union Agency for Fundamental Rights regard experiencing cyber harassment and in-person harassment in the 5 years before the survey. We find that 1 in 7 people in the European Union countries experienced cyber harassment in the last five years before the study. However, experiencing harassment in person remain more common than cyber harassment. We may see that the highest percentage of online harassment are registered in France, the Netherlands, Austria, and Denmark, while the lowest level are found here, Hungary, Cyprus, Italy, and Malta, and Romania. We may note here aspect regarding the human rights. For instance, in the country from the top, they are developed country where human rights are more valuable than the other country which are which actually are emerging countries or not such developed. In the context of pandemic COVID-19, the cybercrime risk registered a significant increase, as in the presented graph. In May, for instance, 2020, 40% of respondents reported a significant increase in cyber fraud risk. Additionally, 60% of respondents expected a significant increase in cyber fraud risk over the next 12 months. So we may find an increase of this risk. When we analyze the average cost of cybercrime by domains, we may note that the highest value of cybercrime cost is registered in healthcare area, followed by energy, financial, pharma, and the other. Also, education are higher than the average. We may provide here the example of our university, not mine, but academic of Academy of Economic Study from Bucharest, which experienced this type of cyber attack on October. So for about 3 weeks, all the data were frozen and couldn't be accessed by students and also by teachers. Regarding the frequency of crime, actually we ask ourselves, what motivates hackers? What motivates them? According with our source, more than a half of cyber attacks are financially motivated, more than a half, while only 13% have an interest to the national state. However, when we talk about the average cost of cybercrime, the cyber attacks towards the national states face the highest cost, as we may see, 4.43 million dollars. As I said before, one of the main reasons of the hackers is related to get financial benefits, which could be in the form of the theft from customers' bank account. Here we have a graph which provides the evolution of card fraud losses during the last 10 years, but also with several forecastings. So we may see from the graph that the maximum level of card fraud losses is registered in 2016. After which, there is a decrease due to the efficiency of the measures adopted by bank for a better security of customers' money. Regarding the total value of card fraud losses in Europe, we see from the same source that the United Kingdom holds the first position, followed by at a fairly long distance by France, Germany, Spain. Romania, as we may see here, has a very small level of card fraud losses compared with the other countries. However, when we check for the evolution of value of card fraud losses, there is a significant increase year by year in Romania. Actually, the value of card fraud losses doubled in the last 5 years. In the last 5 years, if you see the value for
2014,
yes, and the value for 2019, we may see that it doubled. All in all, the general rate of economic crimes in Romania is about 42%, according with the recent data from 2018, meaning that 42% of companies were victims of at least one fraud in the past period. So we may see that compared with the previous years, we may see a very high rate. Now we are moving our attention to present several patterns of the fraudster profile. Regarding the profile fraudster by sex, we have found that men are much more inclined to take risk, and thus the number of frauds in which they are involved is significantly higher than those of women, as we may see from this graph. However, when we check for the position in which men and women are involved, we may see that as employee, the level of losses are generally the same, while for the higher position of manager or owner, the losses from fraud caused by men are far greater, as you may see here. Regarding the profile of fraudster by age, we may found that the highest number of frauds caused by people are caused by people age 36 to 40, about 20%. However, the amount of fraud losses increase as the fraudster age increase also, so that the losses caused by people over the age 60 are the largest. We may explain after this cases a lot of situation, at least the situation which were happened here in Romania. Regarding the education, when we talk about education of fraudster, the results are somehow interesting, because perhaps you would expect that a better education will give better compliance to the rules. We find that the maximum number of frauds, about a half of them, are caused by people who have a university degree. In addition, the amount of fraud losses increases as the fraudster hold more degrees and are better educated. The result would be explained by the fact that a better education ensures a better understanding of the functioning mechanism or of the economic, financial, and informational flows, and in this way they easily may find the gates for getting the illicit benefits. Just several issues at this chapter. Regarding the experience in the same company, fraudster with experience in the same company about 6 to 10 years or even more, actually they cause the highest losses for the companies they work for.
Yes. Ms. Monica, just to round up and a little bit conclude, we can say that men are more prone to being frauded.
Okay, I ask about this because my colleague Mircea has a recorded presentation, maximum 15 minutes. So I was thinking to complete it.
His presentation.
Presentation, yes.
Exactly.
So this is okay. Okay. I will conclude with the profile of fraudster. Of course, here we saw that generally he's a man, age between 36 and 40 years, work in financial field. If it is employed, he commit fraud against his own employer. Generally, he holds a senior position management. He is higher educated, work in the same company for over 10 years, and generally his lifestyle is beyond the reported income level. Just to go to the end, only to talk about, in short, about the measure to combat financial crime. Preventive, punitive measure for international cooperation, measure of recovery losses. Regarding preventive measure, this is directly related to with our topic. we talk about the needs of investment in anti-fraud programs and technology. According with the study, the size of fraud detection and prevention market worldwide actually has grown significantly year by year, and the expectations will be over 4.4 times higher in 2023 compared with the basis year 2016. Also, regarding the investment in anti-money laundering software, the data provide a high increase in this area. Also, regarding the preventive measures, we talk about investment in green lines, which will bring a lot of benefits for the companies. And finally, talking about punitive measures, it's important this graph, because we may found the maximum imprisonment in years for a different country. Actually, the maximum level is about 20 or 25 or 20, but for the developed country, it goes somewhere to up to 10 years. This is this information is very related to the way in which the losses are recovered, because the legal framework use alternative punitive measures to punish criminals, so that criminals most often rather prefer imprisonment than to pay damage. Thus, around the world, about a half of the organizations do not recover anything from their loss. In the Eastern European and Central and Western Asias, this percent is even higher, 61. So we may find that the percent in which the damage is recovered is about 28%. The same percent we find also in Romania, based on our own calculations, on the data source provided by the Romanian police. So the percent is about 28. So meaning the percent of recovery in a total of 100. Going to the conclusions, digital economy determines new dimension of economic and financial crime under the form of cybercrime. Over the last 15 years, the classic frauds under corruption, shadow economy, tax evasion, money laundering decrease, while new crimes under the form of cybercrime and associated crimes to cybercrime, financial frauds, other type of financial frauds increase. More than a half of victims do not recover anything from their loss. Despite the efforts conducted by organizations to combat economic and financial crimes, the global size of economic and financial crimes is growing due to the innovative methods adopted by criminals. So we need a higher protection against cybercrime, which could be possible only with higher education of the people about the risk. I will finish with the statement of Tim Berners-Lee: the web as I envisaged it, we have not seen it yet. The future is still so much bigger than the past. And now I invite to enjoy the reading our book, Financial Cybercrime Regarding Financial Transfers, which belongs to my colleague Mircea Șchiau, and my book, Economic and Financial Crime in Romanian Language and in English, published at Springer House. So enjoy your reading, and
thank you.
Thank you for your attention and for your patience.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Monica. I think through your presentation, you were able to conclude and basically show us what are the biggest figures in the last year, especially due to the pandemic, we can see that at least $2 billion of expenses are raising within cybersecurity, and we expect it to raise for $20 more billion up to 2023. Based on your figures, we understood what is the profile of the we have preponderant men, which are basically committing frauds, and we also understand that digital economy means more risks within cybercrime, and we need to get more instruments related to cybersecurity, since more than half of the entities do not have any recoveries from the losses caused by cybercrime. This being said, since we have other speakers waiting for us, I'll move towards the next speaker, and I'm waiting for him to get connected. But we have with us Georgi Johadze. I really hope I pronounced correctly your name. He's the project manager in Cybercrime Program Office and Council of Europe. He'll give us more inside details related to post-COVID-19 life, especially related to cybercrime and what challenges do we face within the region, but not only. Georgi, I hope you are with us and you can hear us.
Yes, I'm definitely with you, if you can hear me as well.
Yes, we are here. Great. Meanwhile, let me just mention to Monica, please stay with us in order to wrap up with some conclusions in the end together with you. Georgi, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Marina. And also thanks to Natalia, actually, Spinner, for inviting me to speak again to the CyberRit Moldova. It's not the first time that I'm here, but first time, and hopefully the last time I'm doing it virtually. And hopefully next year I can do the same in person in Chisinau.
We are expecting you here.
And also, I would like to thank very much the previous speaker, Monica, for actually outlining several important figures. There was actually a lot of figures, but I think that first, Marina have summed up already that actually we're looking at a lot of money. We're looking at a lot of losses and a lot of potential losses from cybercrime and then financial fraud as well. And I will then explain also the link between the two. I'll try to do it in my presentation. But secondly, I think that we realized that cybercrime actually concerns everyone. I think that one of the things that I'm going to do throughout my presentation is to engage the audience as much as possible. And for this one, actually, I need Marina's help. Can you tell me approximately how many participants we have at the moment participating either offline or online? I need just an approximate number.
I think my colleagues here can help me, but meanwhile, let's move further and maybe I'll come back with a number in a minute.
Sure. Okay, so I can share my screen right now, so I can start with the presentation, but it's not really a presentation. It's more like an interactive, poll. So this is why I need the numbers, just to know what to expect in terms of attendance and in terms of polling as well. So the topic that I will be speaking about is about ensuring cyber resilience through cyber connection. And for the last 5 years, I actually have a privilege of working for the Cybercrime Program Office of the Council of Europe. And the project that I'm dealing with and I currently work for is the project which is called CyberEast. And it's the project which covers the Eastern Partnership countries, the former Soviet states, including also Moldova, in which actually we work as a Council of Europe together with the EU since 2011. So it's actually a lot of cybercrime-related action that we have performed. But again, I don't really want this to be a monologue, so I would like the audience to help me out.
I think
on this one, let's actually go through this together. I think that it will work much better if we just have a conversation between ourselves, if rather than myself speaking for 20 minutes. So what you can do is to go to Menti.com. This instruction will stay on the screen all the time. And use the code displayed there. This code will also stay throughout all of the slides. And tell me a little bit about your background as an audience. So where do you come from? I know it takes a little bit of time to connect and also to, you know, fix your votes, but I think it's worth it because then you get a hold of it, and actually I have a couple of other questions to you during the presentation or during our conversation, let's call it like that, that would also help me to make it more relevant.
So basically we are waiting on the audience, which are, is yeah. now connected with us, to go to www.menti.com and use the code which is right now shown on the screen in order to answer some simple questions.
Yeah, I hope there are simple questions that relate to cybercrime, but still, I think this is the one to do. Okay, so we are getting up to speed, non-governmental, industry, business. I'll wait for a bit more votes, but it's always good to speak to a different audience because compared to actually what we usually work with, who are the actually which are the audiences of law enforcement, prosecutors, judges, it's always refreshing to talk to a different audience, especially coming from the private industry or non-governmental sector. But let's not lose a lot of time here and move ahead, and let me speak on the subject matter. I'd like to actually voice what Monica was presenting in her presentation about lack of definitions, and perhaps you'd be surprised to note that there are not actually, there is not an officially and globally accepted definition of cybercrime. It is. If you're looking at it, for example, even in the Budapest Convention on Cybercrime, which actually our work is based on as a Council of Europe, you will not find it. But I think that we are in a fairly good agreement for the last, let's say, almost 20 years. Actually, we'll be celebrating the 20 years of the convention next year, that cybercrime is not simply the offenses that are against computer systems and data. They are not just the hacking offenses, as we call them. But actually, everything that would have a cyber element, like a cyber-enabled crime, for example, cyber violence, or where technology can be used as a conduit, witness, or even victim of the crime, it could be actually anything that has a cyber element, has an element of electronic evidence in it. And this is a very important definition for actually the scope and reach that we do. Because in many ways, when we are talking about cybercrime, when we're talking about a cyber-enabled crime, the recent figures actually show us that the ones that we collected, 80 to 90% of all crimes have an element of cyber in them. There is at least something like electronic evidence to be found there, to be processed, to be examined in the forensic lab and then brought as evidence. So actually it means the reach of the Budapest Convention on Cybercrime is quite large. It's almost like an entire criminal justice treaty, if you think about it in modern terms. And the second point that actually is also correlating a lot with Monica's presentation is that when what we see working with actually professionals who deal with cybercrime, that in the end, almost all of the cybercrime is financially motivated. It's all about money, it's all about profit, and in the end, whatever the goals are there, whatever is actually happening in terms of, let's say, even state to state hacking, in the end, actually, at least some of the criminal groups will be involved that will be taking the profit. So, for us, cybercrime is a profit that criminals are trying to get online.
It's interesting.
The next question that I would like to ask you, I think that now you warmed up and actually know how to use Mentimeter, the software that you use. Do you actually know how much of reported cybercrime is successfully investigated? And I gave you several options here, like 25%, 15, 5, 1. How much is it actually, really? And I will actually stay here for a while because it's a very important metric to discuss, and that actually will influence what I'll be speaking about in the next few minutes. Okay, so I see that there is even answers. No, I think that 5% takes a lead. I mean, the most of the audience, at least close to majority, thinks that it's about 5% of all cybercrime is successfully investigated. This is a very dire picture. This is a very pessimistic one. Okay, but let me tell you something. In reality, it's only 1% of the crime that is being successfully investigated.
And you said 5%
is the Council of Europe saying.
You said 5%. You said 5% is pessimistic. Then in reality, it's even worse.
There was a bit of a lead, maybe just a bit of a play here with an audience. But in reality, it's 1%. And 1% actually may not even end in the courts being prosecuted, because it's really an acute problem about how the cybercrime is being reported, how it is being investigated, how much resources is actually being put into cybercrime, and which brings us to the next topic, which is a COVID impact. I think that what we have really noticed is that actually COVID-19 has not brought anything particularly new to cybercrime. Probably it's a bit of a blasphemy to say so. But it sort of helped to bring out the problems and amplify the problems that were actually prevalent with cybercrime and bring them to the forefront. So in many ways, again, the COVID-19 impact on cybercrime was actually amplifying the problems that we had as criminal justice systems to respond to security of cyberspace to criminal action. So let me start a little bit with actually the ground that we know best, because the project that I work with works in the Eastern Partnership for the last more than 10 years. And the first thing when actually the COVID struck, we asked our countries, we asked exactly the investigators, prosecutors, judges, what is happening? How much cybercrime is there? I mean, is it increase, decrease, et cetera? And they provided us the responses, also tried to describe what happens there. So not surprisingly, it was exploitation of remote access vulnerabilities, phishing, malware, fake news, which in many countries is not considered a cybercrime. And also in general, there was an increase on cybercrime reported across all sectors. So it was just an increase across all sectors. We also actually contribute in some ways to through a capacity building project to a wider view, for example, the European perspective through Europol IOCTA report, which was published not very long time ago. The latest IOCTA was published in October of this year. And actually it also sort of confirmed the findings that cybercrime is on the rise. It also made an outlook at the strategic sort of threats of cybercrime that are present right now that are going to be amplified in the future, such as social engineering remains a top threat, which actually facilitates all the cybercrime, as well as cryptocurrencies that are used to facilitate payments for cybercrime, but also ransomware, which is, again, the new old. It's been following us since 2017 in quite strong numbers. Online child sexual abuse, unfortunately, is also on the rise. Increasing variety of payment frauds, be it, like, for example, business email compromise, card not present fraud, etc., are all on the rise. And again, dark web, which has a bit of a lesser presence these days, it's still very much a presence when it comes to security and coordination sort of between the criminals themselves and organizational criminal groups. So, and to zoom out and actually to give you also a global outlook, the Interpol report 2020, actually, which was devoted to COVID, this is also not very, I mean, just, it's not a very recent publication, only August 2020, but I think still fairly recent figures. I think that the diagrams on the screen are very much telling in terms of actually what happens and what are the major sort of threats, the cyber threats related to COVID. But I guess the Interpol also gives a very pessimistic outlook that actually further increase is everywhere. And particularly, for example, COVID vaccination phishing will be more prevalent once solutions are actually being more found. And actually, we can see it already happening. So the more news about the positive news about vaccines are there, the more will be actually fraudulent reports to get your personal information in the name of delivering you the fake vaccine, let's say. So with this, we try to also sort of look back and analyze what kind of challenges are there for action against cybercrime for all of the law enforcement. And for law enforcement, actually, not just the law enforcement, but also for judiciary and prosecutors. As I said, I mean, the COVID-19 pandemic really amplified the problems that were present before. We knew that cybercrime units are always overloaded. I mean, the cybercrime units are probably some of the most overloaded police units in the world in terms of the number of the cases they're dealing with. The case load has even increased. Actually, it was also undermined a little bit by shifting of resources because many of these police officers were asked to be attending, let's say, emergency rules implementation, enforcement, let's say, lockdowns, curfews, border controls. So there was even less resources actually available right now to fight cybercrime. Lesser possibilities to interact with victims, obviously, with witnesses to get the evidence from them. And actually what we saw is also a shifting focus on more technical solutions. So instead of actually going after the criminals, it's more of a response of, let's say, taking down malicious websites, which can be actually bringing up the problems of the rule of law if it's not timed down properly. And again, there is an inherent problem of really just you need to train investigators, prosecutors, judges all the time, because we say that our materials are actually, they're good only for 2 years. In 2 years, you have to revise everything and actually account for the new types of threats, for new types of crime, for new technologies, for investigation and for forensics. So basically, it's always the battle that you're playing catch up in here. I would like actually to hear also again from the audience in terms of how do you rank these challenges in terms of impact on criminal justice action on cybercrime? You don't have to be a professional, so I'm just interested in your views on this, in your general views of how do you see the problem. So here you see five sort of challenges that we have identified as an office, but can you please also rank them by a Mentimeter? What do you think is the most acute to the least acute of these challenges?
We understand pretty well that capacity building is probably one of the major problems that we have, since cybercrime means that we have to advance every year, change, and continuously learn new fields of activities, and while keeping a really keen eye on technology and new technologies.
I couldn't agree more. This is actually what the rest of my presentation is about. But okay, I think that we have also a fairly good outlook here, which I think that focus on technical responses is something that I would also reluctantly but still agree with. It's a little bit of a problem from the rule of law perspective, because again, the criminal justice response to cybercrime is still a criminal justice matter, so we have all the safeguards, guarantees built in there in the process. But in terms of takedown of information, websites, especially without judicial approval, you're looking at a lot of trouble maybe further down the line. Okay, I think this is very good, and thank you very much for your responses. Let's now continue to the remaining 4 or 5 minutes of my presentation, which is about how do we do actually react to this problem as a project, which is implemented already for a long time in the Eastern Partnership region. The latest in this in the series of projects that we do is the CyberEast project, which I'm currently heading. Implemented since June 2019, and supposed to end actually for 3 years in June 2022. And the general logic here is actually contribute to both the legal basis, to the necessary skills, but also to cooperation in the end. So it's a process in which we try to go from the basics to the skills necessary to investigate and prosecute, and then to ensure that these units actually talk to each other internationally, but also internally, and they also talk to the private sector, to the non-governmental sector, to financial investigators, cybersecurity, and so on and so forth. So I think in many ways this is a classic capacity building project, so there is nothing really just extraordinary about this. But extraordinary thing has been, of course, the COVID. We are also a regional project, so for us, when COVID struck, it was a lot of adjustment, I would say, on stage one, because we're a regional poor project which depends very much on travel, on bringing people together from different countries together, making just travels from one country to another, also analyzing problems on the regional level, also conducting a lot of actually webinars, seminars, conferences, trainings, and exercises in the countries. And of course, we took the COVID-19 as an opportunity to step back a little and focus on what we have. What kind of resources do we have? So are our studies up to date? Are the guidelines and actually training that we do, are they up to date? Everything that actually we publish on the Octopus community, which is actually the central community for cybercrime professionals, is it up to date? So actually we did a lot of work in the first 3 months from March to May, end of May 2020, on consolidating all the information that we have. And just to shape the response further. In summer months, then we enter stage two, what we'll call sort of figuratively, is adjusting further through cooperative efforts. I think that we realized that we have to also cooperate between the different projects within the office, but also between the different projects within the Council of Europe, projects implemented, let's say, by the EU separately. So actually we increased our coordination through online presence and try to focus on activities that do not actually require that much of adjustment. For example, the master program at the University College Dublin that we support under the project, sending 2-3 investigators per country for studies there, is these days, of course, done online entirely, but also when travels resume, there will be also the studies on the campus. So basically for us, it was easy adjustment to what we could do with the sort of the minimal loss in terms of efficiency of our action as a project. But now we're actually in stage three, where actually we have really adjusted our approach and tried to deliver the same to the criminal justice authorities as before March, but in a different format. So for example, you see there are lots of series of exercises, workshops, etc., that are done in entirely online format. And for the first time, for example, we actually, it allowed us to try something different, for example, support the security of elections in Georgia, you know, that were held in last month in October, actually with multiple activities, including even cyber exercises that we ran online without physical presence of participants, actually, that was delivered from our Boxer Globe to Georgia. And I think that the Georgian elections have been quite secure recently. At least there have not been like a lot of bad news coming out from the results of operations. So again, now we're at stage three, where actually we can say that we're fully adjusted and continue to serve the public that we usually work with. But to put this also into perspective, I think again, as a capacity building project, we have to think about who we work with. And again, we work for increasing capacities of law enforcement, judiciary, prosecutors that are already very busy people, especially busy because they work on cybercrime, because again, cybercrime units are very busy, and they have a very low chances of actually catching the criminals, because please remember that 1% figure, I mean, which is quite amazing if you think about this, that in the end just brings a very pessimistic outlook. I think that what we're going to do is just to continue doing this for a while online, but also with a view of taking back everything offline to the old ways, from June 2021, if situation allows, because again, I think that people-to-people interaction, as you can see on the picture, which is from one of the more recent cyber exercises that we did before the COVID pandemic, is of course priceless, because it allows us to build the bridges between the people, because again, the cybercrime cannot be defeated just by one country, but by cooperation between many. So what do you think is needed to successfully combat cybercrime in COVID-19 conditions? That's my question to you. I will wait for your questions to be displayed here, for your answers to be displayed here, and I would appreciate any comments, if possible. Shut down the internet. We hear that a lot. we cannot, because basically as a Council of Europe, we are actually supporting the vision of the free and accessible internet for everyone. What is required here is more of the sort of preventive but also reactive action to some of the forms of internet activity that are not actually universally accepted. Although cybercrime is rampant, it's not the only activity that happens on the internet, because then again, we cannot support shutting it down or building the national walls or just segmentizing it as some of the countries are doing at the moment. So it's not a vision that we support as a Council of Europe. Good economic alternatives to crime. Absolutely. That's the root cause of prevention of the crime, so I couldn't agree more. Investments. I think that I mentioned there is a severe understaffing and under sort of resourcing of the cybercrime units everywhere, anywhere you look. So in developed or developing countries, it's the same there. So I think investments into people, especially, are going to be the key. And to be careful with personal data. Of course, we are the Council of Europe. That's the approach that actually we also implement for trainings and capacity building that we do, as well as working with legislation, because although we support efficient law enforcement action on cybercrime, it does not have to be on the expense of the human rights and liberties. This is also a part of the Budapest Convention, with actually a very nice video that was playing in the beginning of this particular session. So thank you very much for your responses, and thank you very much for participation. Let me stop sharing my screen. And back to Marina, and stay here to respond to any other questions.
Thank you, Georgie. You basically covered the next step, or the biggest challenges we face right now on the global scale, and what we should work on, and probably the conclusions which are brought by the audience as well in the end is a good way to move little by little to the next speaker. At the same time, please let us know if there are any short-term measures which were taken by the Council of Europe during the pandemic, and if you could list just two of them, that could be great.
Do you want me to answer right now or after the presentation?
It can be just two short mentions right now, and then we can end with the conclusions.
Okay, so first of all, of course, what we did was is something that we're doing right now is migrating everything online. I think it's a safe answer to everything, but I think it's not as easy as it sounds, because we're talking about a fairly complex subject matter, which is cybercrime, which requires a lot of technical skills to be transferred from us to the people that actually are willing to take this and that they have to apply them. So we're involved very much in the implementation of our own actually in-house learning management system that does not simply allow, let's say, the interaction, lecturing, the hosting of courses, but also exercises. So in terms of, for example, sharing the screens and giving direct injects to participants so that can actually do the cyber drills in real time with our actually direct participation. That's actually one of the ways in which we contribute. The second actually is that we took COVID as an opportunity, I think just to turn it into a positive sort of matter, to look into subjects that we have not really looked before. As a cybercrime program office, we're mostly dealing with, let's say, offenses that are within the convention on cybercrime, which are the hacking offenses, child and sexual exploitation, and others, again, computer fraud and computer forgery. But with COVID, we actually took a different turn and looked into different subjects, for example, cyber violence, violence against women and girls. So it's one of the most recent and actually one of the most successful webinars that we had. We looked into election interference. So we looked into how to ensure cooperation between cybersecurity and cybercrime investigators in terms of sharing of reporting and data.
Thank you.
This actually was a response also to invite new topics into our agenda and to focus on that. So these are two examples that quickly come to mind.
Thank you so much. I think you brought about 10 examples, I would say. I know that the Council of Europe is basically putting a lot of efforts in fighting the pandemic and cybercrime in general. Now we're moving to the next speaker, who is Mr. Mircea Schiau. And Mr. Mircea Schiau, you found out a little bit about him within the presentation of Ms. Monica. He is a PhD in public order and national security at the University of Craiova. And now he'll come with a presentation about cybersecurity reactivity in crisis times and critical infrastructures. Please, we'll have the presentation in a little bit, in a couple of seconds. And stay with us, stay tuned until the end. Meanwhile, I'll ask Georgie and Monica to prepare in one sentence the conclusion of the today's meeting.
I start by saying that cyber attacks affect information processing, information transmissions, and command and control systems. Implicitly affects critical infrastructures, and in this context, must not forget that man is one of the most exposed elements to manipulation and methods of hacking. So please don't ignore the old methods like spam, phishing, social engineering, and so on. I'm telling this because most of the attacks start from a simple malicious email or message, like in actions of Lazarus Group, Sofasi Group, Amaredon Group, Emissary Panda, Helix, Helix, Kiyosaki, Mummy Spider, Mythic Leopard, Project M, Wilted Tiger, or Ocean Lotus, which target high-profile military bases, diplomatic entities, governments, organizations, technology developers, energy industries, multinational companies, or just a simple medical unit. Anyhow, any mission of an APT, Advanced Persistent Threat, like APT 3, 10, 17, 27, 28, 32, 34, 36, 37, or APT 40, involves clear stages like initial compromise, establishing points of support, escalating privileges and internal recognition. Lateral movements are essential for maintaining a presence. Regarding of this, CENC command and control servers are the basis of advanced cyber attacks. The danger is real, and I think all levels can be exposed, especially that crime as a service provides tools that allow even the exfiltrations of important military data from many countries, and that can endanger the security of the planet. The cybersecurity packages, user manuals, and technical support are made available for those interested. And this increases the number of enthusiastic at the beginning. At the end, cyber criminals from which future cyber soldiers are selected. Resources allocated by aggressor states for creation, distributed structure, acting on a principle of separate cells. As a unit in a network, have a common blueprint. Contract hackers and specialists, front companies, and an intelligence officer, according to a team of cybersecurity analysts. High-level interconnection mechanisms allow for the transfer of capabilities in overload, offensive, or crisis, defensive situations. Very recently, I read a document and I found out that Signal Intelligence, SIGINT, were intercepting satellite communications from a long time. The document was published in 1989. By Strategic and Defense Studies Center Research School and of Pacific Studies, belonging to the Australian National University in Canberra. So it's old enough, the paper. Very interesting, also which very interesting paper, which states that SIGINT was capable of monitoring the whole radio frequency spectrum on an almost global scale. I just invite you to make a comparison yourself with those mentioned above and just draw your own conclusions. Hope that advanced technologies will solve some of these problems. Regarding communications, in 2016 was publicized an event about the launch of a quantum communications satellite on the orbit, which is supposed to make communications impossible to be intercepted or deciphered, decrypted. After almost 4 years from that event, the people are wondering if the communication photon systems are much more secure, could be hacked or could be put down or something like this. Artificial intelligence and machine learning could be also one of the solutions, only if the modules are tested in a very strict control environment before to be exposed in real life. And I want to repeat, only in a very strict environment, control environment. The two images speak for themselves. Machine learning has two sides, supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Supervised learning, which need human help, and unsupervised learning, when the machine learning is able to take own decision, could classify, could accumulate information and use it on the purpose. So the differences and similarities, I think, that are quite clear. Coming back from the sky, we'll talk about a little bit. We'll talk about an attack on the national water supply system of one of the countries in the Middle East that took place in April 2020. Action that is considered could have had a harmful and disastrous outcome, according to national cyber chief of that country. The reaction was no long in coming, and on the beginning of May 2020, the traffic on the Navy port area in the Middle East near the Strait of Hormuz was stopped and severely disrupted for some days. A number of private handling systems were damaged, and tens of ships loaded with containers were forced to wait outside of downloading area. In the same way, taking control of advanced guidance system of a Navy can lead to collision with difficult to anticipate effects. Like an example, I don't claim that USS John S. McKay Navy ship's collision with a Singapore whale tank was caused by a cyber attack, but if you take in consideration the possibility of taking control of a Navy port and the possibility of taking control of one ship or more ships in the vicinity of the port, of the Navy port, the results can be absolutely disastrous. Just like it happened in the port of the Middle East, it can happen in any port of the Black Sea. If we turn our concrete attention to the criminal cyber actions carried out during the pandemic known as COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2, we will observe different patterns and volumes of attacks applied depending on the transformations secured as a result of social distancing and remote working. Even it's hard to believe, the top three Western countries most affected by the pandemic are also those that have recorded a large number of cyber attacks, campaigns of intimidations, induction of fear and insecurity were followed by so-called information campaigns, which did nothing but deliver malware and collect credentials. The rescue messages were constructed in such a way as to appear to be provided by competent organizations, bodies, and the topic addressed COVID-19 increased the interest in voluntary redistribution. One category includes, among others, messages or emails with malicious attachments sent through online applications, social networking services, and social media. The text, audio, photo, video, and other components are nothing but interfaces that allow the virus to be installed when accessed or run, as in the case of links to sensational information. Against the background of high appetite for information, phishing campaigns are orientated thematically and encourage victims to support forward and spread the messages. Other category includes complex actions, very clearly targeted against some people or some organizations, and from which the aim is to obtain some information of interest for the attacking group, destabilization, intoxication, or just hosting in latent state for a future lateral movement and subsequent reactivation. I must to say that changes in the attacker's strategies impose adaptation measures. In response to the recrudescence of COVID-19-based attacks, defense mechanisms were naturally activated. At the national and international levels, groups of volunteers were mobilized with opinion, sure, the permission of the official IT incident response centers to support the efforts made in combating the pandemic cybercrime effects. Some examples are Cyber Threat Coalition, Cyber Threat Intelligence League, Justice League, and Cyber Volunteers 19 Romania, which are closely working with the Romanian Computer Incident Response Team, CERTRO. In a global crisis, it cannot be said that only one area or only one critical infrastructure is affected. Cybercrime is closely linked to components of financial crime, such as money laundering, fraudulent lending, and sure, with corruption. That's why many states have joined forces, and cross-border cooperation has in some cases prevented losses. In addition to government initiatives, there are those of the global law enforcement communities. Hope that advanced technologies will solve some of these problems. The technical teams can provide much easier support if units enrolled in a given network make efforts to implement a minimum set of recommendations or requests, which would allow for much better coordination in crisis situations. In this context, public-private partnerships are particularly important. We propose as possible solutions the construction of a European common platform with a vertical and horizontal architecture for warning about the potential dangers. Those the construction of C3 modules, community cloud computing in areas of interest for each member of the European Union. Stratifies solutions compliance with the same security rules, and those the adjustment of European legislation in the sense of framing the acts that include cyber attacks resulting in premeditated murders as being culpable homicide or murderous attempt with particularly serious consequences, and the adaptation of extradition procedure in this regard. Of course, the proposals presented, introduced, are not comprehensive, but they can be a preamble to report on which to take decision with medium and long-term effects. Certain sections of the best practice guides may be re-examined and may be mandatory. The security of critical infrastructures depends more and more on IT security, and that is why we consider a priority to align standards as quickly as possible at the European level. Can say no solution should be considered infallible, but the elements of instability must be eliminated, so that the analysis of alternative scenarios allows the delivery of results as close as possible to reality. Hoping I didn't bore you too much, thank you all for your attention, and I wish you to enjoy all the very special information on the conference. Best regards.
Thank you, Mr. Mircea Schiau, for the presentation. As we understand, alternatives in general are important in order to find the best and all possible solutions. This being said, unfortunately, we are out of time, so we won't come back with further details from our speakers, but we are happy that we had you here. It's good and it's interesting to conclude that we are now able to understand and say that actually during the pandemic, we have a rise of cybercrime. But in the same time, the positive effect of the pandemic is that we now understand what the vulnerabilities are, both for countries and for private sector, as well as governmental institutions. This means that we will have to work more. This means that we'll have to invest $20 billion in the next 3 years in order to get those ideal specialists that are going to present and work within the sector and basically make the cyber resilience and cybersecurity on a global scale much more visible. This means that we will be able to return some of the losses which are due to the cybercrime and help us use all the efforts all together united in order to create the digital economy that we want while keeping and understanding the challenges. Thank you for being with us. Stay tuned for the keynotes and also for the next days. Please follow, share, and find the other presentations which are already on our website and on social media in case you missed some of the previous panels. Thank you for being with us.